Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Come on and give God praise. Come on and give God praise. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice. I will rejoice. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh, you're glad. You're glad. You're glad. We're grateful to be able to sing and to come to you. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to read and open up our services today from the book of Psalms, number 27. Hallelujah. One of my favorites. Amen. Amen. This is the Psalm of David. Hallelujah. We're going to start at verse 1. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, come upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumble and fail. Though an host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this will I be confident. One thing, yes God, one thing have I desired of the Lord, that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble, he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me upon a rock. And now shall my head be lifted up above my enemies, round about me. Therefore will I offer in his tabernacle sacrifices of joy. I will sing praise. I will sing praises unto the Lord. Hallelujah. Come on and give God a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. 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 For the reading of his word. Hallelujah. For the edification of our souls. Hallelujah. We're going to ask Sister Christine to bring us a prayer this morning. Amen.
Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. We just want to say thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
we serve, and we are to praise him every opportunity we get. This is the day the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Nobody's going to love you the way God does. Nobody cares about you the way Jesus cares about you. And I'm just so glad that you have tuned in to our Facebook Live presentation. Our service is on today. Drive through for your breakthrough. Come on, parking lot crowd, give God a praise on your horn. Hallelujah. Oh, what an awesome God. He is a mighty God indeed. Hallelujah. I'm Pastor Larry Barnett, pastor here at St. John Praise and Worship Center Ministries in beautiful Pulaski, Illinois. And again, I'm so happy that you've allowed us to come into your homes on your smartphone, your tablet, laptop, whatever technological device you may be using. We're just happy that you have allowed us to spend this time with you this afternoon. And there is a word from the Lord. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we come in the name of Jesus, thanking you for all your benefits towards us. Thank you for being merciful. Thank you for being kind. Thank you for allowing us to see a day that we have never seen before. Now, Father God, I pray that you'll bless all those who have assembled here on the parking lot. I pray that you'll bless those who are watching by way of Facebook. Bless those who are watching by way of YouTube. I pray, Father, that you would touch our hearts, our ears, our minds. Bless us to be receptive to thy word. I pray, Father God, that you would send words of life, words of wisdom and encouragement, words of healing, victory, and deliverance. Father God, we know that you're able to do anything but fail. I pray, Heavenly Father, that you would bless us to not only be a hearer of the word, but bless that we should be doers of the word, lest we deceive our own selves. Father, we bind and rebuke every distraction, every interfering thing, every disruptive item in the name of Jesus. And I pray now that you would bless us, your servant. Give me a greater anointing of the Holy Ghost. Speak to me and speak through me. And for all this, we give you praise, glory, and honor. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, we're just glad once again to be here on a beautiful Saturday afternoon in Pulaski, Illinois. And we're going to feed you twice today. We're going to feed you from the Word of God. Hallelujah. We're going to be studying from the Old Testament book of Esther. Esther chapter number 4. And then immediately, following these services, we're going to be feeding families. Amen. We're going to be giving away a grade A vegetables, mixed vegetables and fruit to the first 300 people or so that will come. We have boxes already for you. All you have to do is show up at 1 o'clock for your drive-by blessing. So we have drive-through for your breakthrough starting right now. And immediately following the message, we're going to get into our drive-by blessings. And also this coming week on Tuesday, that's going to be June the 23rd at 3 p.m. here at the Praise and Worship Center. God has blessed us and put us in position to be able to share once again. On Tuesday, we're going to be sharing boxes of dairy products. We're going to have 250 to 300 boxes of dairy products for those who will come and get it. First come, first serve basis. We're going to be giving away gallons of milk, both white milk and chocolate milk, cottage cheese, butter. Then there's going to also be regular cheese in those boxes. Again, that's going to be Tuesday, June the 23rd, starting at 3 o'clock. Just as soon as the delivery truck gets here, we're going to begin distributing those items. Don't miss that opportunity. Call your neighbors, call your friends, let everybody you know to come by St. John Praise and Worship Center Ministries, 371 Chestnut, Pulaski, Illinois. Again, that's going to be Tuesday at 3 o'clock. Well, come on, grab those Bibles, get your sword, hallelujah. There is a word from the Lord today. While you're grabbing your Bible, we want to grab everybody in your house, tell them to come on and sit down and share with you as we go into the preached word lesson of our services. And I hope you enjoyed our awesome praise team, second to nobody. Of course, unlike every other pastor, I believe we have the greatest praise team and musicians on the planet. Praise the Lord. Esther chapter number 4. Esther chapter number 4. Beginning at verse number 13. The word of God reads as follows. Then Mordecai commanded to answer Esther, "Think not with thyself that thou shalt escape in the king's house more than all the Jews. For if thou altogether holdest thy peace at this time, then shall their enlargement and deliverance arise to the Jews from another place. But thou and thy father's house shall be destroyed. And who knoweth whether thou art come to the throne or the kingdom for such a time as this?"
Then Esther bade them return Mordecai this answer. Go, gather together all the Jews that are present in Shushan, and fast you for me, and neither eat nor drink 3 days, neither night or day. I also and my maidens will fast likewise. And so will I go in unto the king, which is not according to the law. And if I perish, I perish. So Mordecai went his way and did according to all that Esther had commanded him. Now in verse number 14, I want to read verse 14 again. That's going to be our key verse. Verse 14 says, for if thou altogether holdest thy peace at this time, then shall their enlargement and deliverance arise to the Jews from another place. But thou and thy father's house shall be destroyed. And watch this. And who knoweth whether thou art come to the kingdom for such a time as this? And for just a few minutes this afternoon, I want to deal with the subject, for such a time as this. For such a time as this. I want to deal with the fact that there are things that God is doing in the spirit realm behind the scenes, things that we're not privy to, things that we're not aware of, things that haven't even entered into our imagination, that God is somewhere operating behind the scenes. Many times in our life, we go about our day-to-day activities, our daily routine, oblivious to the fact that God has a plan for our lives. Brothers and sisters, family and friends, I want you to know that you're not here accidentally. You're not here by way of chance or coincidence or happenstance, but God planned it uniquely for you to be here. God has a plan. God has a will for your life. Sometimes we fail to recognize that every event, every trial, every tribulation has a purpose in the overall plan that God has for our lives. We think things just happen to us coincidentally. There is nothing trivial that happens in your life. It may seem like a commonplace thing, but if God allows that to happen in your life, it was for a purpose. It's according to the divine schematics that God has for your life. The things that often seem to be routine, things that are trivial, things that to some people seem to be unimportant, are the very things that God will use to bring you into his expectations for your life. God has a plan for you. In Jeremiah 29 and 11, God says, I know the thoughts I think toward you. God has a plan for your life. When it seems like nothing is happening, nothing is going on, I want to encourage you to know that God is doing something. It's amazing to me that we can ever think that this omnipotent God, this omniscient God, this omnipresent God would ever have idle time. God is running the entire universe. And watch this, because you are so important to God, that in the midst of what God is doing, God is also doing something specifically for you. Stop thinking of yourself in terms of I'm just another person on the planet. No, you are more than just another face in the crowd. Aren't you glad that God has a specific plan for you? Well, I don't know about anybody else, but I'm excited when I think about the fact that this great God we serve, the great God Jehovah, El Shaddai, that he has a plan with my name written on the blueprints. Hallelujah. Sometimes it seems like you've reached a point of stagnation. How many of you been there where you felt like your wheels were spinning and you were going nowhere fast? Anybody ever felt like a rocking chair? You know, a rocking chair does a whole lot of work, but it ain't going nowhere. Come on, you'll catch that one after a while. It's like that washing machine. Man, it's watching overtime. You put the extra spin cycle on that thing. It's washing, it's turning, and at the end of the day, it's in the same exact place that it started this job. When we are not spinning our wheels, God has a plan for our lives. God is always somewhere arranging, rearranging, preparing, and grooming us for the assignment that God has on our lives. That's why I said God has an assignment on your life. In the Old Testament book of Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 55, verse number 11, God says, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. Watch what he says. It shall not return unto me void, but God says, it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the things whereto I sent it. So God has an assignment for every word that he speaks. He has an assignment for every word he speaks, and every word that he speaks specifically to you, that word has an assignment that must be completed. It must be satisfied. There is no question as to whether or not it's going to happen. If God said it, you might as well begin to give God praise right now. Every word of God. Hallelujah. We have to remember that God is not limited to time. And sometimes we will allow the construct of time to be an enemy to our faith. If something happens immediately, we're praising God. If it happens exactly at the time that you want it to happen, you don't have a problem in giving God the glory. But sometimes we're praying and submitting our petitions to God, and weeks will go by, months will go by, sometimes years go by, and you begin to think, because the adversary is always in our ears, we start embracing the ideology that somehow God has forgotten about you, or either God has said no. I want you to know that God has not said no, and he has not forgotten about you. God is working overtime on your behalf. God is moving. He's doing something right now. I might not be able to see it. I might not even feel it. I might not even think about it, but I know there is a difference, my brother and my sister, between what you feel and what you know. Some mornings we get up, and if we're honest, and I wish to have some honest people on this parking lot, I wish to have some honest people watching this on Facebook and YouTube, who would admit that sometimes you get up in the morning, you just don't feel like praising. Don't feel like going to work. Don't feel like getting up, even putting your clothes on. Sometimes all you want to do is stay right where you are. But there's something on the inside, hallelujah, something begins to motivate me, something begins to provoke a praise out of me and say, boy, this is still the day that God has made. And so I get myself up and I give God a praise. It doesn't matter what I feel like, I give him a praise because I know God is deserving of the highest praise. Do I have a witness out here today? 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 38, the apostle is writing, and Peter says, beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as a thousand years, and a thousand years is as one day. So when it seems like God is dragging around on your program, just know that God is not limited by the same box of time that you and I are limited to. God is always moving. And what I love about God sometimes, and I believe that perhaps we got it wrong, we used to would make a statement that God would step out of time and do this and do that. But when I think about who God is, he does not have to step out of time. God is able to do in a minute what it will take you a lifetime to accomplish. That's the God that we serve. You may start off at the back of the line, but the way God reckons time, immediately, instantaneously, you find yourself right in the front of the line of blessing. Somebody ought to praise him right about there. The planning and the timing of God is revealed in his season. Pastor, what are you saying? You can't rush God. You can't force the hand of God. We can't make God move when we want God to move. But when we submit to God's timing and God's season, we will always get there on time. He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So the Bible says, if I faint not, so in the interim, while I'm waiting, after I've submitted my petition, let me submit this to you. Most people don't know what to do after they get done praying and asking God for something. Most people, let me say that again, most people don't know what to do with themselves after they have submitted their petition to God. After they said amen, they don't know what to do. Let me tell you exactly what you need to do. When you have prayed to God, when you sought the face of God, you submitted your petition to God, the minute you say amen, you need to get off your knees and start praising God like you've lost your mind. That's an indication that you're saying to God, God, I trust you. I knew you heard me, and it's already done. Aren't you glad it's already done? Hallelujah. It's already done, and I'm glad about it. Well, this afternoon, I want to use for a backdrop the narrative of this text, the book of Esther. I want to deal with the fact that you are in your own season now. You're in your now season. You're in your now season. Hallelujah. I just want that to sink in. I want that to sink in. You are in your now season. You're not waiting on God. God has already set things in motion. Right now, my brother, right now, my sister, you are in your now season. Hallelujah. You were born in the right time. You're in the right place, in the right season, with the right equipment for God to use to get the job done. You have everything you need to be successful. You have everything you need to be victorious. God already put it in you. God has already given you the plan. He's already downloaded some stuff in your spirit. Whether you recognize it at this time or not, this is your due season. I want to affirm to you that God has raised you up for such a time as this. That there are eight interesting things in the narrative. Praise the Lord. Don't worry, I'm not going to spend 10 minutes on each 8 item. I want to hit 8 things real quickly, 8 points that I see in the book of Esther. It deals with 8 critical factors: insubordination, opportunity, replacement, conspiracy, exposure, betrayal, reversal, and advancement. Let me say that again. 8 critical points in the book of Esther: insubordination, opportunity, replacement, conspiracy, exposure, betrayal, reversal, and advancement. Even though it's only 10 short chapters, it covers approximately 9 years of the reign of King Ahasuerus, otherwise known as King Xerxes. It is in this text that we find the very familiar story of Hadassah, also known as Esther. We find the story of Mordecai, and in the story we find again King Ahasuerus or King Xerxes. We find Queen Vashti and wicked Haman. Those are the principal characters, and in the backdrop of all of this, we have the nation of the Jews. We have the Hebrew nation who will be pointed out, singled out in this particular story. It's in the book of Esther that we find the account of Vashti, Queen Vashti, who's beautiful beyond compare, and she allows her beauty and her title to get her beside herself. Hallelujah. There's some folk now who have that Vashti spirit who sometimes get caught up in themselves. It's Vashti who shows rebelliousness at the order of the king. And so because she thinks she who he is, she is. And sometimes our biggest downfall in life is to believe that you are who you are. Oh, come on, let me say that again. When you start thinking it's all about you, you become your own worst enemy. The worst thing I can do as a pastor is start thinking that I'm somebody because I'm Pastor Larry Tyran Barnett Sr. That's a dangerous trap to fall in. I must not think of myself more highly than I ought to think. Hallelujah. It's in the account of Vashti's rebellion and the anger of King Ahasuerus that we find God beginning to put some things in order. Hallelujah. God will use other people. He will motivate their behavior to elicit a response out of somebody else on your behalf. Let me say that again. It just looks like that the king is upset with his wife. And because of his anger, things happen only to her. But when she does what she does, she sets the wheels in motion for replacement. Hallelujah. Let me see if I can work this real quick. You got to keep everything in its proper perspective. When Vashti rebels against the king, she not only rebels against the king, but she rebels against the crown. Let me say that again. She rebels against her husband, but greater still, she rebels against the crown, the government, the seat of authority. And because of his viziers, his wise men, they show up and they say, wait a minute, king, we got a problem. If you allow Vashti to ignore you and to rebel against you, we're going to go home and all of our wives will do the same thing. It will come to pass that the whole nation will be overrun with rebelliousness. So he begins to listen at his advisors to get his wife in order. It's in this book that we discover that anybody can be replaced. Come on, somebody. When you start thinking you all of that, you can be replaced in the twinkling of an eye. When you become egotistical, narcissistic, when you think of yourself more highly than you ought to, you will soon discover that you are truly expendable. I don't care what your title is. You might be the apostle, you might be the prophet, the evangelist, the pastor, or the teacher. You can be replaced. You may be the deacon, you may be a church mother, an usher, you may be the praise and worship leader. Whatever your official title might be, you can be replaced. Well, it don't just stop in the church house. You can be a congressman. You can be a senator. You can be an assemblyman. You can be a mayor. You can be the governor. Yes, you can be the president. Number 45 can't be replaced. Oh, praise the Lord. I'm not here trying to be political. I'm simply stating a statement of fact. All of us are expendable. And when you get out of pocket, when you get beside yourself, the Bible says that God resists the proud, but he gives grace to those who will humble themselves. God knows how to abase one. He knows how to exalt another. God is in control. There are no powers that be, except God allows them to be. So when you begin to think that everything is centered around you, God already has a replacement to take your place. As I was studying this text, let me get to the text. I thought initially that God was going to have me to deal with people who can't, won't, and don't follow leadership. Let me say that again. I thought God was going to really have me just dealing with rebellious church people. You know, every congregation got folk in the congregation, in the ministry, who either won't, don't, or can't follow leadership. If you say one thing, they're going to do something else. Praise the Lord, somebody. If you do the other thing, they'll do what you said in the first place. They just simply will not follow leadership. And I really thought maybe the message was focusing on rebelliousness in the household of faith. But I discovered it's greater than that. Hallelujah. I'm suggesting, I'm telling you that you ought to follow leadership. As a matter of fact, when I thought about it, I thought for sure one of the background scriptures would be Hebrews 13 and 17, where the word of God says, obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourself. Hallelujah. Y'all know what that said. As they that must give an account for your soul. And the Bible said, do it in a manner that does not grieve them, for that's not profitable for you. Because when you go back and study the text, Vashti grieves the king, suddenly finds herself divorced, put out, and cast out. I believe that all of us would agree that it was not profitable for Vashti. It was her insubordination that caused her to find herself in an unprofitable situation. So because of her rebelliousness, she's terminated. The king fires his wife. How do you just fire your wife? You don't always have to go to court. Let me deal with some married folk. You can be living in the same house with a man or woman for 40 years and be fired. Oh, y'all got real quiet. Hallelujah. Let me take you back to another passage of scripture. King Saul is anointed. He's appointed to be king over all of Israel. 2 years into the reign, he gets fired by God. And he keeps on going to work for 38 more years. Somebody ought to shout glory right about there. Hallelujah. She's terminated. She's fired. And it looked like that was an issue simply between the king and the queen. But because of her termination, God now creates an opportunity for Hadassah. Oh, praise the Lord. When it looks like somebody's being put out, sometimes we fail to recognize and realize that the wealth of the wicked has been laid up for the righteous. But you've got to be righteous in order to get what God is laying up for you. Here she's occupying the throne, she's fired, and now God makes an opportunity for Hadassah. Saints of God, you have to always be ready to step through the door when God says opportunity knocking. You can't always be somewhere fitting to do, and I know that's not a word, but you know how we do. I'm fitting to do this, and I'm fitting to do that. You can't be fixing to do anything when God calls you. Your response must be, here am I, Lord, send me. You got to be ready. When the Holy Ghost is moving, he can't wait for you to get your praise on. You should have already been praising. When God says go here, you ought to already be walking. Pastor, well, how do you know that? Jesus said, go ye therefore. We should have already been going. It should not have taken a shutdown for the saints to be out in the hedges and highways witnessing to men and women. It should not have taken the church to close its doors before we began feeding the masses. We should have already been doing that. We should have already been helping this one and helping that one. We should have already been loving our neighbors out of hell into glory. Hallelujah. Slow down, Pastor. Don't start preaching. Hadassah has a door, a window of opportunity open for her. Now you have to look at the life of Hadassah. Hadassah's obedience to Mordecai, her cousin, who raised her as his own daughter, allows Hadassah to step through the door of opportunity when God opened it. Hallelujah. As the Lord dealt with me about this entire story, he revealed to me 3 P's for breakthrough and victory. 3 P's for breakthrough and victory. Person, position, and purpose. Person, position, and purpose. Those are the 3 P's for breakthrough and victory. Let me deal with that. Regardless, let me deal with person. Regardless as to who you are and how long you've been in ministry or how long you've joined a particular congregation, it's imperative that we know who we are. It's a dangerous thing when we forget who we are and from whence we've come. We can never forget that God brought each of us out of something, but he did not just bring us out. That's one part of the paradigm. God brings you out, but when God brings you out, he's always bringing you to. Somebody needs to get that in your spirit. God brought you out of drug addiction to bring you to something greater. He brought you out of promiscuity to bring you to something greater. God brought brought you out of poverty to bring you to something greater. He brought you out of bondage to bring you to something better. When God brings Israel out of the house of Israel, he brings them to the promised land. God never just brings us out so that we can hang out and go back to the pit pen of life, but he brings us through in order to bring us to. I'm glad God always, always, always has an end game for our lives. It's dangerous when you forget that. It's dangerous when you forget whose you are. We all had a starting place. Hallelujah. Let me encourage some of you. Maybe you just started out in ministry. Maybe you just got saved. Don't stop measuring yourself by people who have been preaching and ministering for 20, 30, or 40 years. Don't compare yourself to another saint who's been studying the word of God for 10 years. You thank God for where you are right now. Everybody has a starting point. Maybe you just started your business. It may look like it's not going to succeed, but I want to remind you to despise not the days of small beginnings. You got to thank God for your starting point. Everybody ought to give God praise. Lord, thank you for my starting point. Hallelujah. It's my starting point that reminds me of the great things that God has done in my life. It is who we are, hallelujah, that we have to focus on sometimes. We got a lot of people in the church who act like you were born into greatness. You act like you were born great, that you didn't have to work at anything. You didn't have to pursue anything. I'm reminded that greatness is birthed out of great trials and tribulations. I'm a firm believer that greatness is the offspring of adversity. You need some adversity in your life in order to push you into the plan and the will that God has for you. Hallelujah. It's who we are, and more importantly, whose we are, that reminds us of our struggles and the journey that God took us on. We ought to never forget that it was the outstretched arm of God that brought us from a difficult place to where we are right now. Hallelujah. Hadassah, after she has been picked to be one of the virgins, auditioning, if I can use that term, for the next queen. She spends a year preparing herself. Go back and read the text. She spends at least 6 months beautifying herself with myrrh, and then another 6 months with sweet odors and the things that women use for purification. She has 12 months to pamper herself just to look good for a minute. Come on, somebody. You talking about a do-over? You talking about a makeover? Sisters, sometimes you got to work with what you got. Hallelujah. Stop looking at yourself as being an inferior product or you less than some other woman. No, baby, you just need to fix up what God already gave you. Sometimes we got to put ourselves in a period, in a time of preparation. God spends a year getting her ready. She knows how to walk right. She knows how to talk right. She knows just how to dress, how to wear her makeup. She knows how to smell and how to be a lady. Somebody ought to give God praise right about there. Hallelujah. Let me step on out there. If I was at the praise and worship center on the inside, I would tell you that breast, thighs, lips, and hips don't make you a lady. Come on, somebody. It takes more than the physical anatomy of your body to make you a lady. It's an inner quality that needs working. It needs refining. It has to be produced in the fires of God's love. So she gets herself ready. It's Hadassah whom the king looks at, and he falls passionately in love with Hadassah. She's no longer the little orphan girl. She's no longer the little peasant Jewish girl. She's now the queen. She's no longer referred to even as Hadassah, but now she is Esther. She's the star. Come on, somebody. Her name Esther means star. She's a star amongst the stars. She's the superstar. Out of all the virgins that he could have selected, he falls upon Esther, and the king said, this is the one that I've got to have. Saints of God, it may look like you're nothing right now, but all you need is just a little time with the king. 1 minute with the king can turn your destiny around. 1 minute with the king can turn your world from being upside down to upside right. We serve a mighty God who knows how to get you to where you need to be. It's critical, saints of God, that we never lose sight as to how we got to where we are. When you finally get somewhere, don't tell people, I had to hook up. Don't tell somebody, I was in the right place at the right time. Don't you talk about your degrees, your education, your intellect. You'll be quick to give God the glory and the honor. Sometimes we need to look at where we are and decree and declare, I'm here by the grace of God. Aren't you glad that God has put you where you are? Hallelujah. In spite of all your successes in life, regardless as to the heights that God has allowed you to ascend, you have to remember that at the end of the day, we are still a filthy rag in the presence of God. On your very best day, we are children of the King who have been saved to serve. For 5 years, after her wedding, after her coronation, 5 years. 5 years go by, and everything is going well for Queen Esther. But then, in the fifth year, all hell breaks loose in the kingdom. She isn't even aware of what's happening. And we can assume that she has a feeling of being insulated from what her people are dealing with. But in the fifth year, things begin to turn upside down. It's at this point in the story that Mordecai and the Jews and all the provinces, and remember that the King Ahasuerus, he has 120 provinces that range from India all the way to Ethiopia. And so, and all the provinces now, all the Jewish people are ripping their clothes and putting on sackcloth and ashes, everybody except for Queen Esther. But how many of you know this afternoon that when you get done looking at your title and your rank, when you get done looking at your achievements, your accomplishments, and your so-called imagined privilege, hallelujah, you still have yet to arrive. Just the minute when you think you're sitting at the table, the same people who sat you at the table will pull the chair out from under you. In the book of Psalm 51, verse 5, the Bible says, "Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me." Don't you ever start thinking that you are somehow reaching a level of perfection that the rest of us can't achieve. I don't care how perfect you are still imperfect. You are still that item of sin that God had to suffer, bleed, and die on an old rugged cross to redeem unto himself. You have a few degrees and initials behind your names, but don't you start thinking that your name is greater than every other name. You may have some money in your pocket, you may have position, you might even have a little authority, but you better remain humble. The same ladder of success that you climbed, brothers and sisters, you can come down that ladder faster than it took you to get up. You still fall short of the honor and the glory of God. Don't you ever forget where you come from. The second P for breakthrough and victory is position. Position. When you know who you are, you have to know that God strategically positions you to occupy a particular spot. Despite her destined humble beginnings, hallelujah, despite the fact that she's an orphan being raised by her cousin Mordecai, she knows how to be humble. She knows how to follow leadership. God looks at her resume. God looks at her pedigree. He looks at her lineage. And everything about her destiny says disqualified. But God catapults her to a position that her resume and her pedigree just doesn't seem to support. How could God take this Jewish girl and make her the queen over the Medo-Persian Empire? She don't even belong there. She's not even supposed to be with the Medes and the Persians except in a position of servitude. She's insubordinate. She's a second-class citizen, but now she's on the throne. What I love about God, God don't care what you came out of. He doesn't care what your last name might be. He doesn't care about the history of your family. When God decides he's going to promote you, he's going to do just that. He will position you where other folk don't want you to be. They may not want you there, but they can't get rid of you. I almost started shouting right about there. They may be working against you, but God puts you there, and there's nothing they can do about it. Aren't you glad that when God opens the door, nobody can shut that door? Somebody give God praise right about there. Hallelujah. Somebody needs to know and understand that position is something that God has developed, created, and prepare for you from the foundations of the earth. It's not a new thing with God. He knew from the beginning what he was going to do. Hallelujah. And he just strategically puts you in the place where you need to be. Don't you let the adversary or some super anointed religious individual convince you that your past somehow disqualifies you. Thanks to God, we got to stop looking at people's past, acting like that they're too dirty, too nasty, come out of too much stuff for God to use them. Their testimony is as sweet to God's ears as yours is. Their praise is just as sweet as your praise. Hallelujah. The same Jesus that died for you, died for them. Quit looking at somebody's criminal past and say they can't be trusted. If God can trust them, hallelujah, if God can deliver them, I can trust whatever God does through them. Your haters, your critics will do all they can to destroy your dreams and assassinate your visions. But you got to hold on to what God has spoken over your life. Hallelujah. You got to maintain your sight, your focus on your person and your position that God has called you to do. When you walk in the will of God, you can go through any storm and still be in the place that God wants you to be. He will look beyond the veil of privilege. And some people, I realize in America, believe themselves to be privileged, even though they deny that there's privilege simply because of what they look like. But your privilege can't get you to where God is trying to take you. God sent me to tell you that in spite of other folk's privilege, God will still position you at the table where he wants you to be. And when God opens the door, he doesn't just open that door only for you. He opens that door so you might be a blessing to other people. Hallelujah. When God sits you in high places, it's no longer just for you. It's not only exclusive for you and your family, you and your friends, you and the people that look like you, talk like you, walk like you. When God blesses you, you turn around and you open that door for some other person. Hallelujah. When we are the person, when we're the person that God would have us to be, and we occupy the position that God has prepared for us to occupy, then we need to know what our purpose is. And therein is the conundrum. Sometimes we know the person, sometimes we know the position, but then we forget our purpose. We forget our purpose. Don't you ever forget your purpose. Every now and then, we forget our place, where God has placed us. Sometimes pastors lose sight of their kingdom purpose. Are you hearing what I'm saying, Pastor? We begin to believe that the sheep are there for us, to feed us, to sow into us, to pour into us, to be used by us, to be manipulated by us. And we lose sight of those things. That's why a lot of people have developed a negative taste in their mouths because of some pastor who really wasn't a pastor but a hireling. Because the pastors who are pastors after God's heart, we know that it's our responsibility to feed the sheep, not to placate the sheep, to tell the sheep what thus saith the Lord, whether they want to hear it or not. It's the real pastors, it's the real men, the real women of God who don't mind being ostracized and criticized, even voted out, because you dare to stand on what God called you to do. We have to remember our purpose. My purpose is not here to see how many women I can manipulate from the pulpit. It's not my purpose to see how many yes men I can create. That ain't my purpose. It ain't my purpose to make you even live right or holy. Oh, I lost somebody right about there. It's my purpose to tell you how to do that, to give you the tools, to give you the wherewithal, to give you the unadulterated word of God, to rightly divide this word of truth. My purpose is to be a witness for the Most High God. That's my purpose. My purpose is to love you as Christ would have me to love you. By this shall men know that I am the disciple of the Lord. When you know who you are and the position that you are to maintain, you better know that God put you there so not that you can have cuteness heaped upon you, the accolades of men, the praises of men. You're not there because of your gifts, your talents, or your charisma. Sadly, too many people have fallen in love with their gifts. See, people love it when I talk about the pastors, but let me talk about the musicians a little bit. Let me talk about the singers a little bit. Let me talk about the praise and worship leaders a little bit. Let me talk about the deacons and the mothers just a little bit, because sometimes we get in these positions and we start thinking, I'm all of that. Everybody wants me to sing. Everybody wants me to play. If you don't pay me and you don't treat me the way I want to be treated, I'll pack up my instrument. I'll pack my voice up. I'll pack up my intelligence, my money, and go someplace else. Brothers and sisters, you can take all those things and still not make heaven. Hallelujah. Now let me show you how good God is and how much God loves you. I'm running out of time. When we forget who we are, God will raise up a Mordecai. You ought to give God praise for a Mordecai. God will raise up a Mordecai when you forget who you are. It's Mordecai who takes it upon himself to remind Esther of her background. Mordecai, once Esther gets into the palace, the Bible says he was in the court every day. Every day he's in the court reminding his cousin who she is, reminding her of her purpose for being on the throne in the first place. It's Mordecai's voice, the voice from her past, that reminds her, Esther, don't you forget who you are. Whose you are and why you are. In Esther chapter 4, let me get there very quickly. Mordecai begins to tell her about her purpose. In verses 13 and 14, let me read that again. The Bible says, "Then Mordecai commanded to answer Esther, think not with thyself that thou shalt escape the king's house more than all the Jews. For if thou altogether holdest thy peace at this time, then shall the enlargement and deliverance arise to the Jews from another place. Watch this. But thou and thy father's house shall be destroyed." Notice what her cousin says. Mordecai says, "And who knoweth whether thou art come to the kingdom for such a time as this?" I've come in the midst of this pandemic, in the midst of great social, political, and racial upheaval to encourage want you, the people of God, to remind you that God has raised us up for such a time as this. I really don't have time to get into the dastardly, diabolical plan of Haman. Haman is a hater. It's Haman who looks at Mordecai. He hates Mordecai because Mordecai, being a Jew, would never ever bow down whenever Haman would walk by. Haman is the chief vizier. He's the king's, his chief advisor. It's Haman. Haman who devises this plan to not only get even. See, let me do a little teaching. Hallelujah. If you got to log off, I still love you. But I just got to break this down just a little bit more in detail. You have to really go back and do the historical analysis to find out why it is that Haman hates Mordecai so much. It is Haman who's an Agagite. An Agagite is a descendant of King Agag. Agag is an Amalekite, praise the Lord. It's the Amalekites whom God speaks to wicked King Saul, and he tells Saul, see, you got to take care of your business when you can. He tells King Saul, I want you to utterly destroy the Amalekites. I want you to kill Agag, kill his children, kill everything that he owns, every man, every woman, every child. But Saul doesn't do that. And so now we fast forward. Matter of fact, let me go back another few generations, because when you go back and you study it, you're going to discover that Agag is a descendant of Esau. Esau is the brother of Jacob. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. So you have this long-running hatred, this feud between brothers that's being carried out generations later, because now Saul doesn't take care of business. So here we are, fast forwarding in time, and now here a descendant of Agag is in position of authority. He hates Mordecai, who is a descendant of Benjamin. Hallelujah. Benjamin is a descendant of Jacob. Lord, help us in this place. Here we have this hater now who has this ulterior motive, because here we have a man who's a Jew because he's a Hebrew, he's a Jew. He refuses to bow down. It's against that commandment. You don't bow down to any man. You don't worship any man. And now because Agag hates him, he says, I'm going to get rid of Mordecai. Not only him, but I'm wiping out all the Jews. See what happens if you don't deal with a mess in your life when you have an opportunity to, it'll creep back up on later on. That's the reason why some people, you need to unfriend them on Facebook. If they're from your past and your past is wrong, don't stay connected. Some people in your phone, you need to delete that number. Don't you text them, don't write them, don't email them, definitely don't message them, don't do anything with them, but delete them and keep on moving. It doesn't mean you don't love people, but it's an indication, it's a voice saying, I refuse to be connected to what God delivered me out of. Had King Saul only had done what he was supposed to have done, we might not even hear about Queen Esther. So he devises a plan to kill him. Hallelujah. But look how God operates. God takes this man, Mordecai, uses him to save the king's life unbeknownst to Haman. He reveals a plot. Conspiracy, there's one of those eight points. The conspiracy is revealed through Mordecai that men were going to try to kill the king, going to King Ahasuerus. And Ahasuerus forgot all about it. He's bored one night. This night he's bored. He's bored. He's sitting there. And he says, bring me the Chronicles. Read to me. Hoping that he will fall asleep. As they're reading it, they read about the story, how Mordecai saves his life. And the king said, did we do anything for him? Did I reward him? Did I honor him? And he said, no, king, you didn't do anything. So Haman is in the outer court. He's trying to get an audience with the king, praise the Lord. He's been invited to a banquet that Hadassah is going to throw. And watch this, because the king invites him in, and he said, Mordecai, what should I do to somebody who saved my life, who did all these great things for the king? And surely Haman is thinking, must be talking about me. See, when you get full of yourself, when you walk in arrogance, when you're narcissistic and you think everything revolves around you, praise the Lord, that certain days are great because you said something about them. Lord, don't let me get into that. Hallelujah. I just want you to know it is what it is. Here he is thinking it's all about me. And the king says, what would I do to them? So watch what Haman does. He said, you ought to get your robe, get your crown, go get your horse and get your ring and put it on this man and ride him through the town so everybody knows that's what he did. He said, tell you what I want you to do. I want you to take my robe. I want you to get my crown. Go get my horse, take my ring and put it on Mordecai. Look what God will do. He will use your haters to bless you. He will use your haters to elevate you. He will use your your haters to announce your promotion. You won't have time to brag on yourself. God will make your enemy brag on you. Somebody ought to give God praise right about there. I'm telling you, God will raise you up for such a time as this. Let me hurry on to my conclusion, because in this wicked age in which we live, when it's easy to be politically and socially correct, God has raised up some real men and some real women who understand the time, and they know that God has called them for such a time as this. When men are marrying men and women are marrying women, somebody needs to know that God has raised us up for such a time as this. When there are members, hallelujah, in this society who think it's okay to kneel on a man's neck for 8 minutes and 46 seconds, somebody needs to know God raised us up for such a time as this. Even though social media can be viewed as a wicked thing every now and then, God will use Facebook, social media, for such a time as this. When pastors are so misguided to believe that slavery was a curse to the enslaved, but the white man's blessing, I came to tell you that God has raised us up for such a time as this. Somebody's got to cry loud. Somebody's got to spare loud. When demons are launching an all-out attack on the people of God, fighting us tooth and toenail, men and women of God need to step up and realize God raised us up for such a time as this. When COVID-19 has closed church doors, God has put us on the outside, raising us up for such a time as this. No wonder the Apostle Paul declares to Timothy in 2 Timothy 4:2-3, he says, preach the word, Timothy, be instant, be in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke with all, exhort with all long suffering and doctrine, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but they shall heap to themselves, hallelujah, teachers having itching ears. Be encouraged, my brothers and my sisters, and know, whatever you go through, that God has raised you up for such a time as this. Maybe you're listening to this message and you don't know the Lord as your personal Savior. I want to extend an invitation, one that Jesus extended when he suffered, bled, and died on an old rugged cross, just to save a wretch like you and me. I want to invite you to say this prayer. Today is a good day. A good day for you to get saved. A good day for your name to be recorded in the Lamb's Book of Life. If you pray this prayer and mean it sincerely from your heart, God will save you right now. Repeat this after me. Father, I come to you, a sinner in need of salvation. I'm asking you to save me. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. And I believe, God, that you raised him from the dead, that he died for my sins. I'm inviting you to be my Lord and my Savior. I renounce Satan and sin. I turn my back on the world. Lord, you said, it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And because you're not a man that you should lie, nor the son of man that you should repent, I'm saved right now. If you prayed that prayer and you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you are saved right now. And we welcome you into the body of Christ. And we give God praise. We're rejoicing with the angels of heaven. The Bible says they're rejoicing over one soul that comes to the Lord. And we are rejoicing with you. Welcome, my brother, my sister, to the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. What an awesome day it is today. Put it on your calendar and note it every day that God saved you and delivered you. Give him praise right where you are. We want to pray for the rest of us, Father, in the name of Jesus. I pray now for my brother, my sister, my friend, my family that's watching by way of Facebook, that's watching by way of YouTube, those who are gathered on this parking lot. I pray, Father, that you will bless them abundantly so. Meet every need in every life. Where there's sickness, I speak healing. Where there's fondness, I speak, Lord, deliverance. Father God, where there's chaos, we speak peace. Where there's trouble, I pray, Father, that you would be a present help in the time of trouble. I pray, Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you would strengthen them, that you would encourage them, those who may have strayed away from you. I pray, Father, that they will hear your voice softly and tenderly calling them back to your side. Lord, we pray for our president. We pray for our governors, our mayors, every legislator, Lord, every congressman. I pray in the name of Jesus that you would touch their hearts, that they would do those things that are right for the people, that they would do those things that are right, just and pleasing in your eyes. I pray, Lord, that you would speak to America, speak to this nation, remind this nation, oh God, that if we would just repent and turn from our wicked ways and seek your face, Lord, that you would hear from heaven. You would hear our voices and heal this land. I pray, Lord, for racial healing in this nation. I pray, Father God, that you would bring us to the table of unity, lest we continue to destroy ourselves. Lord, your word says a house divided against itself, that it cannot stand. I pray, Lord, for every doctor. I pray for every nurse, every caregiver. Father, I pray for every CNA. Oh, God, those who are on the front line of this pandemic, we continue to pray for them. Lord, that you would keep them, protect them from this virus, bring them safely back to their families. And Father, we're careful in all of this to give you the praise, to give you the glory, to give you the honor. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, God bless you. God bless you, Facebook family. Friends, we thank God for you. Hallelujah. We're out of time, but we're never going to be out of order. I want to invite you to come back on Wednesday at 6 p.m. for our Bible study. There is a word from the Lord. It's going to be somewhat a continuation of last week's message that was dealing with, does God have a plan for your life? We're going to continue on with that in a slightly different vein, but it's going to be similar message dealing with dedication and commitment. That's going to be Wednesday at 6 p.m. Now on Tuesday, please come Tuesday at 3 p.m., 371 Chestnut Pulaski. We're going to be giving away 250 to 300 boxes of dairy products containing white milk, chocolate milk, cottage cheese. There's going to be butter as well as regular cheese. And it's going to be on a first come, first served basis. We want you to be here. Come so we can get it out quickly. We have a refrigerated truck. We don't want anything to spoil. We're going to make sure it's good and cold for you when you get here. That's this Tuesday at 3 p.m. Well, as I always like to say at the conclusion of our services, we love you and we want you to stay blessed by the best. God bless you. God keep you. God bless you.